You are listening to the Knightline Sports Network, brought to you by Travis Dever and the Dever Team, 386-690-1636.
Welcome to the Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast with me, your host, Sam Albuquerque, a part of the Knightline Sports Network. You can go ahead and follow me on Twitter at Sam B. Albuquerque. You can go ahead and do that on Instagram if you want to, but again, I don't know. I'm going to repeat this every week, guys. It's just pictures of my lovely girlfriend and me traveling. If you like that stuff, that's cool. But if you want to get my sports takes, Twitter. Come on, guys. Twitter. Sam B. Albuquerque. At Sam B. Albuquerque, anyway. You can go ahead and also email the show if you want to get in touch with us. Send me an email at sam.b.albuquerque@gmail.com. Albuquerque spelled like the city in New Mexico. A-L-B-U-Q-U-E-R-Q-U-E. But you probably knew that. You guys are smart listeners. You listen to this podcast, so you probably knew that. Go ahead and rate, review, and subscribe to the show. 5 stars are always appreciated. Today on the show, my good buddy, Kevin Rafuse, is on. We're going to talk some hoops. Don't worry, football heads. We'll talk hoops in the beginning, but also we will get to the NFL and talk about week one and some other stuff. But in the hoops segment, me and Kev really dive in on the Clippers and just what's happening in the conference and conference finals coming up. So stay tuned for that. That's actually going to be in the beginning. We're gonna flip it this week. We're going to do a solo at the end because the solo is a little bit more informal. It's not an opening segment. It's just NFL thoughts. And I'll tell you about those NFL thoughts right now. We're going to go over week one and just tell you about how that's going. I'll describe how much I hate DirecTV, which I do. And you'll understand why a little bit later. I'll give you my NFL MVP rankings at the moment. And then I will actually research some NFL betting lines and give you my picks for the week. I got 3 of them this week. I was 1-0 unofficially because I don't remember what all of my picks were. If I made multiple picks because I thought I did, I don't remember. I know that I picked the Rams and they won, so I was right. So 1-0 for the week. We'll find out how I am after this week. But first.
Yeah, so if you just take a left at Albuquerque, you'll get where you need to go.
See, you know, I knew I should have made a left turn at Albuquerque.
Here's your host, Sam Albuquerque.
The soft intro works sometimes, but it has to be the right thing.
And
that's the thing. Like, and the thing.
Well, is, yeah, I don't want. I mean, as much as I love it, I don't want the. Oh my God! Hang on. I just saw. Look at this meme. Florida in 1819.
The Majesty Building.
Oh my God, I gotta send this to Gene. That's so funny.
That is hilarious. Like, that thing has literally been here since I moved here as a kid. Yeah, I moved here in December 97. And I think they started construction like within like a year or two since I've gotten here. Because I remember it going up and like, oh, that's a cool building. What's that happening?
Yeah, well, that was always.
And then it just stayed that way.
Like, the first times I would drive to Orlando from Jacksonville, it would always be like, oh, look at that building. And it kind of became the like unofficial welcome to Orlando. And that was just me naturally like not even knowing that. And then I didn't realize it was unfinished until I got ready to move here. Well, I'm like, wait, it's not done.
Now it looks like a silhouette of a building. So like when you see it, it kind of like, oh. It's, you know, it's just an office building, whatever that is. But like for a good 15 years, it was always like on its way up.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like the facade of it wasn't done.
Mm-hmm.
And so now it looks more finished and it's less of an eyesore. I don't think it's a pretty looking building, period, but it's at least done.
It's so random. And you it's there. I mean? And yeah, everything except the base is done.
Looks done anyway. That voice you hear is Kevin Rafuse, host of the Drive and Dish NBA podcast and anchor of Orlando's Evening News on WDBO 107.3 FM and 580 AM here in Orlando. He's also a Big J journalist. I'm on my way to becoming a Big J journalist.
You're going to have a higher degree in journalism than me.
But I don't have a bachelor's in journalism. So like
you have a master's.
Well, I don't have one yet. I'm working on it. Started this week.
Masters, but like,
it's tough, man. AP journalism sucks. Like, the reason why I was so last minute about this podcast, because I was writing up a piece this entire, or essentially for the past, like, 2 hours.
Yeah.
It's hard.
I mean, it's a grind, but it's cool. And, like, I mean, you're going to, like, you can flex on them a little bit. You're going to Northwestern. It's a very prestigious journalism school.
Sight.
Just a little light.
Sight. It's cool, though. I mean, it's all Zoom for me this fall.
Have you bought Mad Purple stuff yet?
No, I've had a couple purple stuff just because of my Orlando City days.
Oh, okay.
I got some free gear from that.
Yeah.
And then they sent me a hat and like a little like a cup, sort of like your Eagles cup, but way less cool. It just says Northwestern Medill on it. It's fine. Like, I use it to drink soda because it has a little straw on it.
Nice.
Did you know that if you drink, like, Coke, like, normally, mm-hmm. and it gets on your teeth, it, like, degrades your...
Enamel?
Yeah, enamel. Yeah, so that's why people recommend drinking soda with straws.
That makes sense. I haven't done it down to that scientifically, but, oh, yeah, like, soda is... It's not good for you, man.
It's not good. Overall, probably bad for your health, but bad for your teeth, too.
I was a big soda drinker growing up, and I just stopped on a dime, kind of, after my first semester freshman year of college. First semester was bad because, you know, you get up there and you just have unlimited freedom. And so I was drinking like a Blue Mountain Dew every night.
Yeah, no one should give 18-year-olds unlimited freedom.
Yeah.
I can't confirm that. I lived at home for my first couple years of college, and that was probably a good call. Like, I said the same thing when I got my license. Like, I got my license a year later. Mm-hmm. I was like, if I got my license at 16, I'd probably a bad idea.
I was kind of like that, too. I don't think it was a full year later for me, but I don't think I took my permit test for... It was at least 6 months after I turned 16. Everyone's like, oh, you going to the DMV right away? And I was just like, I'll get there.
It's like, where am I trying to go?
Yeah. So, and I mean,
it's not like my parents were going to give me a car anyway at 16. Like, I didn't get a car until the Christmas before my 18th birthday. So my birthday would be in March. So like 3 months before I turned 18, they got me a car. And it was a 98 Honda Civic.
Yeah. My first car was, I forget what year it was. I think it was 96. It might have been, it was either 96 or 98 or something like that. But it was a Geo Prism.
Geo Prism.
Yeah.
Nice.
Oh, yeah.
I have no idea what that looks like. I'm about to look it up.
It's actually a small car. I mean, it's just like your typical standard four-door type deal. It was real small. It's like a V4 engine. It was a crazy
I got
first
you. Yeah,
car.
My Civic kind of looked like this. I'm looking at an 02 one. It's a Chevrolet Prism, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. My Civic kind of is in that range. The issue with my Civic was always that the windows, it would work when it wanted to work.
Yeah.
So if you rolled them down, there was a chance they weren't going to roll up.
Yeah.
And a lot of the times it didn't. And
that's a problem in Florida.
Yeah. No, yeah, definitely. So I always
rains every day.
Yeah, the AC was fine, so I just always kept the windows up.
Yeah.
But it was always a risk whenever I did that to order like drive through. I would always just open the door.
Yeah.
Like, hey, Big Mac, please.
Yeah, right. They'd be so flustered every time.
Yeah, exactly. Before we get to the NBA, because obviously, Driving Dish, NBA host, you are Philly before NBA. What's up with your Eagles? Tell me how. Like, I want to have a Philly sports corner every time we talk.
Okay.
And just give me your reaction on the Philly sports team currently. Right now, you have the Flyers who got knocked out of the semifinals.
Yeah, second round they got knocked out.
And then the Eagles, tough loss to Washington.
Yeah.
How are you feeling right now? I guess we could talk about the Flyers, but that was a little bit before.
Well, the Eagles first, I guess we'll start there. I mean, it was a 17-0 lead that they had. So to blow that and lose that game, there's not really a great way to feel about it, I guess. I've told you off the mic that I don't really like the Eagles. I have wild expectations for, like, in that I don't know what to expect, really. Like, the Eagles could win 4 games or the Eagles could win 12 games, and it wouldn't surprise me. I'm certainly leaning a lot more towards 4 after week 1 than I am towards 12. But, you know, the NFC East is still a pretty bad division at the end of the day. I mean, all three of the 4 teams lost the first week. Washington beating the Eagles is the only NFC East team to get a win. And so I think, you know, to that token, though, the Eagles didn't have a lot of key players in the first game, Lane Johnson being the biggest one. Yeah. I mean,
what's that crazy stat about Lane Johnson that if he doesn't play in a game, you guys have like a terrible record?
Oh, it's horrible. I forget what it is, but Carson's winning percentage just goes in the toilet when Lane Johnson's not playing. And they're already without Brandon Brooks, too, with the Achilles injury. Yeah. They're going to miss him for the entire season. So the right side of the line was already suspect. I mean, it got down. I think we were playing like our 5th string tackle at one point. Yeesh. Washington's got a really good defensive line.
Yeah,
so
Chase Young came in blazing.
Yeah, Ryan Kerrigan, they just ate up.
Matt Ioannidis, Jonathan Allen, just a lot of guys. Feasting. A lot of first-round picks on that D-line, too.
Yeah, and I mean, so I think that made it super tough. The left side is still the same. Seumalo is a guard. Jason Kelsey is still obviously at an all-pro level. He's the man. Jason Peters is kind of washed at this point.
That's why you guys weren't going to start him at left tackle.
Well, right. He was going to play guard. And then, obviously, of course, the injury to Andre Dillard forced that. Miles Sanders was out, too. So, obviously.
Yeah, killing my fantasy team. I drafted him as my RB2.
Yeah. Well, he'll be back this week. So, that's the good news. And, I mean, going into week 2 against the Rams, which, you know, looks to be a pretty difficult matchup, you've got Miles Sanders back. You've got Lane Johnson back. Both confirmed saying they're playing. They'll go a long way. The defense looked all right. I think it's a little tough to have any big takeaways from them there. The offense, again, I mean, Carson Wentz has got to be better, too. That's the other reality. I mean, he threw, in my opinion, a backbreaker, the game swinger before Right before halftime when he threw that interception, set Washington up for the first touchdown. All of a sudden, 17-7 going into half, it's 17-0. And they end up losing the second half. And so, you know, you gave him that life. You gave him that momentum. You know, I think the Eagles will be all right.
Yeah.
I don't think
what is the outlook now? After week one, do you have a sort of more, I want to say, perspective on what you think the season is going to look like?
I just said it'll be average. I don't think, I think the Eagles still could very well win the NFC.
Do you blame the averageness on Carson, or do you blame it on a specific injuries? Like, what is the thing that's making this team be average? Is it injuries, or do you think Carson is? Because right now I'm at the point where I have always been enamored with Carson Wentz's talent, and I would argue that he's, like, I've had thought processes in my head about, would I rather have Lamar Jackson or Carson Wentz in the long run? Like, I know that that answer is Lamar.
It's Lamar.
But I've thought about it. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't know Lamar's longevity with his running ability and his skills as a passer. I know that Carson Wentz's style wins championships. Not him per se, but that style of quarterback that can do some magnificent things with his legs and his arm. Not taking anything away from Lamar, because everyone knows how great Lamar is. I love Lamar. But the more and more I watch him, and I think Russillo is the one that makes this point, is people give him credit because he does things that no one else can do. But then he makes, like you said, back-breaking mistakes like that interception, or just holds the ball too long.
Yeah.
It's like too many times. Have you gotten to the point with Carson that you think that this is just who he is? He's going to be erratic. He's going to make these mistakes, but he's also going to make those wild plays.
Yeah, I think he'll be a little erratic. And I think that's kind of – that's a I guess it's part of, because he can make those plays that just look like Houdini sometimes.
Yeah.
I feel like that's often his Achilles heel then, is because he feels like he can do that all the time, when in reality, it's just like, yo, Carson, get rid of the ball. Yeah. Like, just because, I mean, like you said, he's got to be among the league leader of just getting strip sacked. You know, he had another one in the game against Washington in week one. That's kind of been one of his issues, is that he just holds onto the ball too long. Sometimes he tries to extend the play. And, you know, even if he does for that extra split second or two where you're like, whoa, this is crazy, nobody else can do this, it still may cost you once in a while. Now, of course, you'll have some crazy plays where you're just like, how on earth did he do that every once in a while too? But, I mean, that's the downside to that. But, I mean, Carson, it's like, this is his team. It's his opportunity to shine. I think last year, just dragging that team into the playoffs shut a lot of people up, because A, he stayed healthy the whole year, and B, they were just, I mean, look at the receivers he was throwing to at the end of the year.
That, I think, was the thing that pushed him over the top. Like, okay, he had a good season.
Yeah.
Is how, like,
put the
question to Greg Ward, who was a great college quarterback at Houston, not a receiver.
Right.
So I'm with you on that. Anything on the Flyers before we move off of Philly Sports Corner?
The Flyers probably have the best outlook of everybody in Philly right now, honestly, just because, you know, the Flyers, yes, it's disappointing that you lose in the second round just because of how well they were playing at the end of the season and how good they looked in the early on round robin. But at the same time, it's like you took the Islanders to seven games. Yeah. There's still a pretty decent infusion of young talent that should be coming up here in the next few years. You know, you got Oscar Lindblom back at the end, who beat cancer this year. An incredible story there.
Well, I didn't know about that. But
Nolan Patrick is another one who the Flyers' number two overall pick, who didn't play at all this season because he has chronic migraine syndrome, literally was getting migraines like every other day or something like that. You know, God bless there. I, as a guy who gets migraines once in a while, I hope for his sake, just in life, that that gets dealt with. But you get that. You got Morgan Frost, a couple of other guys coming up. Like, the Flyers' core, outside of their main notable players that everyone knows, Claude Giroux, Jake Voracek, are all still really young. Sean Couturier is still there. He just won the Selke Award as the best defensive forward in hockey, and really as well has just
best
put it together.
Best defensive forward?
Yeah.
Is that, what does that mean?
So
I'm not, again, not a hockey guy. Yeah. So when you say defensive forward, they feel like oxymoron.
No, I know. He's the best. It is exactly what he says he is. He's the forward who plays the best defense. He plays a big role in the penalty kill.
Okay, gotcha. I thought he was a defender who also played forward. I'm like, isn't that just a midfielder?
It's usually
at
a
this
mix.
Point?
So it's a mix where you'll have this. You'll have a situation where you get, like, Patrice Bergeron is the main one in Boston, who's been kind of the winner in the face of this award the last few years, where it's just he's an excellent defending forward, but you also have to have a little bit of, like, offensive ability as well. Like, Couturier scored at least 20 goals this year. I think he was closer to 30. So this isn't just like a Tony Allen, for example, NBA equivalent award.
So it's not like defensive player of the year. It's just defensive player.
No.
It's like best two-way guy,
it. It's the best two-way guy.
Cool.
And then, like, obviously Claude Giroux and Jake Voracek are getting older, and so I think there are some concerns there, but they just have such an infusion of young talent, and they're still useful. Like, that's the thing is G and V you know, Claude Giroux shifting to the wing has done a lot to kind of extend his career. And Jake Voracek was really solid, including in the playoffs against the Islanders. So I think while fans are frustrated, the outlook is still looking good, pretty good
better
there.
Than,
and obviously
than
Carter
the
Hart. Right. And Carter Hart between the pipes. You know, the Flyers haven't really had a steady goalie since Bernie Parent or even Ron Hextall, I guess, in the 80s. You know, that's kind of one of the things as a Flyers fan is you're always used to that goaltending carousel. Now it finally looks, hey, the Flyers have their goalie for the next 20 years. It's a weird feeling. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
But it's
exciting. As someone who doesn't know anything about hockey, the one thing I do know, hot goalkeepers can win Stanley Cups.
They can.
I knew maybe like three of the names you mentioned. So Patrice Bergeron, obviously from the Bruins, I've heard him.
Yep.
Claude Giroux, and I think that might have been it.
That's probably it.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Those would be the casuals. I mean, they've been good for a long, long time, both of them.
And nothing on the Phillies. We don't talk baseball on this podcast unless we're making fun of them. Do you want to make fun of the Phillies?
I mean, their bullpen stinks. Like, you might as well go out and try out for them at this point.
I can only throw like 60 miles.
That may be good enough to pitch in the Phillies bullpen.
if it's a knuckleball, maybe. Let's talk about what you're actually here to talk about and what you, even though you are an expert in Philly sports, but what you're an expert on your podcast, which is basketball. By the way, Driving This NBA podcast, download it wherever podcasts are available.
Yeah, pretty much anywhere.
Cool. So obviously the big story in basketball that happened earlier this week on Tuesday night. We're recording this on Thursday night during the Heat-Celtics game too, so just FYI for you guys listening. The Clippers blew a 3-1 lead.
Yes.
Against the Denver Nuggets, who me personally didn't respect very much.
No.
I think a lot of people feel that way. I think that people look at them as a good team, not a great team. I guess the first question that came to mind, who's to blame the most here?
In game 7 or
just overall? Because, I mean, in game 5, 6, and 7. Is it Doc? Is it Paul George? I don't think you can really put it on Kawhi, but maybe it's Kawhi because he's the best player on this team.
I think you can for game 7, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he scored 14 points and was a minus 21.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think I want to say the answer is Paul George just because I trust Kawhi Leonard in those moments, and I've seen it with Kawhi Leonard. And as much as I want to give Doc grief, at a certain point, like Paul George shot 4-for-16 from the field in a game 7 of the Western semifinals. I think he's most to blame. Even though Kawhi Leonard shot worse, 6-for-22, I still know that Kawhi can get it done in those moments. I don't think Paul can, and I think that seeps into the rest of the series.
Yeah, but I also think at the same token, like, you just have to take it in a vacuum, and I don't want to shoot Kawhi too much bail. I mean, you know, Paul George shot a 3 off the backside of the backboard in that fourth quarter, but Kawhi also had a move where he took like 4 steps, jumped into 3 defenders, and then fired off a jumper falling away, and it was just like, Kawhi,
yeah,
like, what are we doing? Are we really forcing this here? I think it goes all around, because I think the initial blame goes to the team for just allowing it to get to game 7, because here's the reality: in games 5 and 6, Kawhi Leonard and Paul George are both pretty good, and when you get to a game 7, weird things like them shooting both miserably can happen. There are a lot of other things too. The supporting cast. I mean, you know, look at Sixth Man of the Year Montrezl Harrell. He was terrible in these playoffs. I mean, he straight up got played off the floor at some points with Jokic. Lou Williams was great on the offensive end, but was a total turnstile on defense, and that's something that, again, you worry about. You know, the depth just wasn't there to get it done. And I mean, it just comes down to a chemistry thing as well. And that's the other reality, is that the Clippers just didn't have any chemistry all season. Now, I thought Kawhi Leonard and Paul George were so talented that it just wouldn't matter until they got to a conference final type deal against maybe a Lakers, or you get to whoever you're playing
just
in
too
the finals.
Much talent on the squad.
I mean, I thought the Clippers were going to win the finals. I'm not going to lie. Like, this is a really, you know, I thought they could just get past the chemistry issues. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you look at the teams that are left between Denver, between the Lakers, the Heat, and the Celtics. They all like each other. They all enjoy playing with each other. They all have identities.
They're also built in a way, as a roster construction, they were built in a way to, I guess, complement each other. When you look at AD and LeBron, and obviously they don't have the shooting that they want with the Lakers, but Danny Green was a guy who can shoot. Kyle Kuzma can shoot relatively
but
well.
But I still think the Clippers had depth, though.
No, I think they have depth, but I think I said this from the beginning of the season till now, is you brought in two players who offensively don't mesh, who do the same thing offensively that they can't work together, and you apply that sort of logic to everywhere but Lou Will and Montrezl Harrell, I think kind of fits. Like, I think Marcus Morris in New York before he traded for him was shooting the ball lights out, but he was also the main player on that team. You take a guy who was the main offensive point and you ask him to be a corner three-pointer and defender, you're asking him to play a different role. I think roster construction-wise, guys like Michael Winger and Lawrence Frank have a little bit of blame here, and I guess Jerry West as well, but he's not technically the GM. So,
well, and again, it just also comes back down to the fact that they didn't really play each other enough. You didn't know what their best lineups are. And yeah. Doc Rivers deserves a little bit of fault that's for that as one. Well. As it's like you didn't make adjustments either. Like when you blow a 3-1 series lead, something has to happen at some point. And it just feels like they never did that. And there are just other things. I mean, the way they blew it was just the most shocking to me. I mean, you're down 8 going into that fourth quarter, which is already enough of a gut punch. You have Nikola Jokic on the bench for 6 or 7 minutes to start that quarter with your season on the line in a game 7. And no matter what Paul George says, this is a championship or bust season.
Yeah.
And they extended the lead. Like, that is absolutely unacceptable and should be concerning if you're a Clippers fan, where it's like, you know, how does this happen? And the reality is it's just that. I mean, that's probably the most bitter way you can end that season. I mean, when JaMychal Green got in the lane and just missed that dunk, I was like, oh, it's happening. Like, you just can see it sometimes. And, I mean, anytime you blow a 3-1 lead, it's certainly a meltdown.
Yeah.
This was a full-blown, like, Chernobyl-esque meltdown. They couldn't get anything going in that fourth quarter. And they should be beating that Denver team. That's the reality. Yeah. We've had these conversations again off the mic. Like, I'm a pretty big Denver defender.
Yeah, we've had the Jokic discussion a lot. Like, I've said that if Jokic is your number one, you can't win a title.
And Jokic is the best center in basketball.
I stand by that still, even through this.
Yeah,
I stand by that. And I guess depends on who you consider a center. Like, I would pick him over Embiid.
I would take him over Embiid.
I wouldn't pick him over AD. Though.
I don't think AD is a true center.
So that's
for the sake of this argument, that's where I'm kind of getting it at. But though I think Nikola Jokic is definitively right now a top 10 player. I think he's pushing top 5. I don't think he's in the 5 for what it's worth. But
I would have to do my rankings again. But I think he's in the top 10.
My 5 right now, without thinking, only because I actually did like kind of sit down and make a list in some order right now, is LeBron, KD. I'm assuming that he comes back and is still the same. Giannis, Steph, and Kawhi. I still have Kawhi in my 5. Yeah. I bumped Harden out. And then I think the next 5 is Harden, AD, Luka, Jokic, and then that 10th spot is kind of up for grabs. It's somewhere between Dame and Embiid and... I mean, I don't know. There's so many guys that are knocking on the door. That's the thing. I mean, it might be Jimmy, honestly. It could very well be Jimmy Butler.
If Jimmy leads this team to the finals, I think he's in a legitimate top 10 conversation.
Yeah.
Because you can't be the best player on a team that gets to a final and not be a top 10 guy.
No,
I
agree.
That's the criteria for a top 10 guy. Can carry a team. Well, not carry because this team's really good, but can be the leader of a team that gets to a finals.
100%.
You mentioned the Nuggets, and I want to get to them in a second. But before we do that, I want to touch on Doc Rivers, because we both, you said it just now, that he has to take some of this blame.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think Ballmer takes it so far that he fires him? And if they do fire him, who would you want to put in that situation? We had this conversation, I think, over text a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
Who do you think they replace Doc with if they do end up firing him?
I don't think they should fire him for what it's worth. I think you just give him another year. I think because of the chemistry thing and them not playing together, I am willing to give them another year.
Yeah, you said something that's really important here that I want to add a note to. Giving Doc another year would mean that next year, both Kawhi and Paul George, I think, could be on their way out.
Yeah.
So if you don't succeed next season, they both can leave.
I think that's going to happen regardless, though. And I think that's the risk you're now playing with, is that you are in a one. And I mean, especially the pressure's on, because I think it goes without saying the Clippers gave up a king's ransom to get, you know, I know everyone points in a vacuum to just, oh, that's what they gave up for Paul George. But the reality is it's also the cost of landing Kawhi. Like, that's just what you got to, they don't get Kawhi Leonard if they don't make that trade for Paul George. And so I think that is the cost of doing business. You know, if it starts and they struggle and they disappoint, then I think, you have to make a move early on. But I don't know.
You would fire in season.
Yeah, I would fire. Oh, yeah, I would fire in season if you have to. But I mean,
you got Ty Lue there, so you have a guy who's won a championship.
And that's why.
If
Ty hasn't.
That's assuming Ty doesn't take a head coaching job.
Well, and that's the question. Does Ty Lue get hired? But if not, you still have Ty Lue in the wings ready to go. And clearly he's taken over and led the team to a championship while taking over for a firing in season.
Yeah.
So, you know, there is a little bit of a precedent there. I mean, besides that, I don't really know who will get looks. There are a couple people. I mean, Nate McMillan comes to mind. Billy Donovan comes to mind. I mean, they were two of the bigger let goes, I should say. You know, Billy Donovan basically kind of signaled that he doesn't really want to stick around in OKC for a rebuild. So the Clippers are clearly in a win now situation. Nate McMillan, I thought, has done an excellent job in Indy. He kind of got hosed earlier this year. I mean, Brett Brown's on the market. He's another one who just got fired. I don't really know if I'd replace Stock with Brett. I mean, those are the, and then obviously Ty Lue. I mean, Ty Lue just being in house and that familiarity. I mean, he's probably the one that comes to mind the quickest.
My thought on Lue, Ty Lue, is mainly that he feels like a Doc replica. Mm-hmm. Like, obviously they both have this sort of role player in the NBA, you know, experience when they actually played in the league. They're both pretty sound defensive coaches. I think they're limited creatively, creatively, offensively. But I think their real skill set and their real asset is their ability to manage stars. But if you're going from a guy to, like Doc, who is known for managing egos and stars, to a guy like Ty Lue, who's known for managing egos and stars, there's no real difference maker unless you think Ty is just an enormously better head coach, and I don't think that's necessarily true. I think it feels redundant to make a move to go from one guy that's similar to another guy that's similar. I think if you're going to fire Doc, you have to go extreme the other way.
Yeah.
And I think the answer is Mike D'Antoni.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, D'Antoni be interesting, and he's the wild card. The other name that I didn't think about that is coming to mind now is Kenny Atkinson.
Kenny Atkinson, yeah.
Just because, you know, he's another one where I thought he did an excellent job in Brooklyn. It feels like he kind of got hosed a bit, and that kind of went under the radar, obviously, because he got fired right before the pandemic started. D'Antoni would be wild just because, I mean, it's not like the Clippers are – like the rumors with D'Antoni right now are him going to Indy, which is always kind of weird to me just because they're built big with Miles Turner and with Sabonis.
I think the Indy thing is that the reason they fired McMillan is that they think they have a better roster than they do as far as the organization, and they want to – and I think McMillan was really like just trying to make the pieces work.
Yeah.
And in the offense
ended up being – McMillan's fault. They all got hurt.
Yeah, but he, I think McMillan did the best job he could. I think that team is limited, where I think they think if you add D'Antoni to that roster, you add that creatively, offensively, shooting a bunch, three-pointers, that it will take them to the next level. I don't think that's necessarily true. I think D'Antoni to the Clippers is sort of Houston Rockets on steroids. Like you're probably going to do something similar, 7 seconds or less, shoot a bunch of threes. You just have better players to do it with.
Yeah.
Like, I think Kawhi is probably not as good offensively and less of a 3-point shooter than Harden, but defensively you don't have those issues anymore. So,
and with Kawhi, it just doesn't feel like. Like, it's tough for me to write a full on just the book, I guess I'm trying to say, on Houston's offense, but it sure feels like after how many years that will come the late games with Harden, you just know what's happening. He's either taking the step back three or he's going to try to drive and get contact.
But that's the thing.
Kawhi is such a killer in the mid-range that it almost like when the game breaks down, that ugly type of offense works. I mean, we see it working in Miami with Jimmy Butler. I think Kawhi's mid-range spray chart is just absolutely ridiculous from this past postseason, game seven notwithstanding. And to your point, like, they're not really a bigger oriented roster. I mean, they've got Zubac, they've got Montrezl Harrell.
Yeah, Zubac's a rotational big. Like, I had him in LA, and I was mad when we lost him to the Clippers, or traded him to the Clippers for poor cap management. Thanks, Rob Pelinka. But he's just a rotation
right.
guy. He's not a star. He's not an all-star. No, he's never going to make a defensive team.
And because of that, I think you can run something like that. And it's not like D'Antoni teams are really built around defense anyway. So.
Yeah, the only guy that's really going to get slighted is a guy like Montrezl Harrell who can't shoot. Mm-hmm. But I mean...
Yeah, but if Trez can run to the rim, that's all he'll have to do. Like, he has to play the Clint Capella role, essentially.
Yeah, and unless they go full micro ball like they did in the last half of the season with
Houston. Trez was virtually unplayable at points in this Denver series. So
here's
the
thing. And you can get pieces back. You can recruit one of those first-round picks for Trez, I think. You can get a first-rounder to maybe a Lakers. Like, I think the Lakers would trade a first-rounder for Trez. I don't think we have any, but we would.
Yeah. You got to get creative with that depth somewhere.
Yeah. Let's move on to the Nuggets, because I think this is an important question coming out of this. Is obviously we can blame the Clippers for blowing a lead, but we also have to give the credit to the Nuggets for coming back and beating them in three straight games. And and the question that pops to mind is, did we overlook the Nuggets, or did the Clippers just implode? Like, are the Nuggets better than, at least especially me, think, or are they still a tier two sort of team?
Oh, no, they're definitely better than you think.
I think it's the royal eye.
Yeah, I think it's a two-part question, because I'll be the first to say that I thought the Clippers were winning the title this year, and I thought the Clippers were going to pretty easily handle Denver. Mm-hmm. Like, I've been high on Denver the whole year, but like, I thought this was a 5 or 6 game series. To that token, I've really, really been impressed with two players these playoffs on Denver that have stood out for me, besides Jokic. Obviously, Jokic being able to play at the end of the games has kind of shut up his narrative. The main one is Jamal Murray. I think it goes without saying, just carrying the offensive load. He had 40 points in game seven. They gave him a lot of money to be that true number two star. There were questions, especially in the first round, where he had a pretty bad series of games from games two to five, where it's like, is Jamal Murray really that guy? You gave him a lot of money. He sure looks like it right now. The other one has been Gary Harris. Gary Harris, you know, Denver's issue is that they couldn't defend anybody on the perimeter, and they still don't have Will Barton, which is what makes this more impressive, is that they're missing probably their best perimeter defender. But Gary Harris has really made an impact on both of these series since coming back in, and it has just given them that extra little bit that they need on the perimeter to get by. You know, Jokic is just out here doing Jokic things. Jamal Murray, like you said, has stepped up on that scoring end. You've got Jeremy Grant playing great defense, another guy who's locked in. Michael Porter is giving you contributions that you hoped when you'd get out of him, even if he's, you know, throwing his teammates under the bus. That people forget about that when you start winning some games.
Yeah, and then they forget that you scored 2 points in a game seven.
Yes. Denver is good, though. I mean, that's the reality. Is I think Denver is always in that. Like, I had... Going into the playoffs, I probably had the two LA teams in that like championship or bust tier one. And then right below it, I would have had the top Eastern teams and Denver. Like, I think Denver was always a little better than Houston, than Dallas, than Utah, than OKC, than some of these other teams. Like, it just it felt like Denver didn't get that respect as being a tier up from the rest of the West. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'll be honest, they didn't look like it, because going into the Western playoffs, Utah was the one team that just kind of didn't really scare me that much. I didn't think they had enough offense, especially with Bogdanovich going down. I'll credit Donovan Mitchell. He sure enough tried to do it all himself, and Mike Conley too finally
almost
got going. But I mean, Denver's won six elimination games. Like, I still can't kind of wrap my head around that.
That's
crazy. They're going into the conference finals, and they've won six elimination games. There's just and for me, it goes back to, it's crazy, but you know, there was that moment when Marcus Morris went after Paul Millsap up 3-1 and like really said, you know, pack your bags and get ready to go. Millsap didn't back down, and it was kind of one of those like draw the line in the sand, and now here we are. I mean, Denver looks like the best young core in the NBA when you look at the way it's going.
I mean, if you're going to think that Jamal Murray is going to be this guy who's capable of scoring 50 points a game every other night, essentially, because that's sort of what he's done in the playoffs, and he can average like 25 a game, especially in game sevens, he can score 40, then yeah, you can make that argument, because Jokic is a top 10 guy, and if Murray keeps playing like this, he's probably a top 15 guy. But that's the question. Can he sustain this, and can he do it on an even bigger stage now? Because you said, won six elimination games in a row, right? Now, I guess in a row, because if they didn't, they wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
But can he do it against the Lakers now on an even bigger stage, on probably an even better team? It's going to be interesting to see with Murray. So from there, I want to talk about this actual Western Conference a matchup against the Lakers and the Nuggets. As a Laker fan, I'm not scared at all. I think this is going to be...
It's on brand.
Yeah, and it is on brand. And I think the Clippers fans probably felt the same way. So it's a little fearful. And one of my good friends would always say, you don't have to be scared to get knocked the bleep out.
Yeah.
And so maybe that's what's going to happen here. And I know maybe the Nuggets are going to be better than I anticipate, but I don't see anybody stopping AD. Like, Jokic is good offensively, but... what is he going to do on the defensive end?
So this feels hypocritical, because we just dropped an episode this week, and I kind of said the same thing at first. When I was like, it sounds ridiculous after Denver comes back, but I feel like the Lakers are going to win the series in five, which to me discounts everything I've just said about how good Denver is.
I said six because I think Murray can drop 50 on any
day. I think I'm at six or seven now. Like, I'm quietly getting talked into. I'm like, at what point do I just stop sleeping on this Denver team? Like,
when they win a title, that's what happens. We as people who watch the NBA, is when you do it, I will believe you.
But
until then,
taken...
like, Giannis is the perfect example of that. We've gotten to the point with Giannis where he hasn't done it, so we're not.
But you don't think Denver's
taken
the leap and kind of answered some of the questions that they had from last year, like when they lost in the second? Like, to me, when they lost in that second round game seven, they had a number of questions, and now just by getting to the like, this is an overwhelming success for me for Denver.
Yeah,
even if they lose in the conference finals,
this
is absolutely
a
successful season for the Nuggets.
And I don't view them how I viewed the Trailblazers last year. I thought the Trailblazers got there randomly, like but like by surprise.
Well, it
like,
felt like they were on the right side of the bracket.
Yeah.
Like, it just felt like they didn't have to go through Houston or Golden State last year. That second round matchup felt like the conference finals.
Yeah, but and I don't say this to say that the Nuggets didn't surprise me to get past the Clippers. That was a surprise, but I think the Nuggets are good enough to beat a top tier team. Yeah. I don't think they're good enough to win a championship yet.
I think they're good enough to win. If they can get by the Lakers, it's just like at what point, like what else do I have to see when they've taken down both LA teams and like and Utah at this point? Like Denver absolutely is a real contender. Now, again, this sounds kind of ridiculous. Well, that's not fair, actually. I think of the four teams left, I probably rank them.
Oof.
I don't know. It's like second or third. See, I don't think. I feel like they're a little better than. I mean, I don't know. I picked Boston in seven. So to that token, I feel like I should have them third. But I kind of feel like Denver would beat both teams in the East. I think they'd be seven game series the way they are now. I think
they would beat Boston because there's no way Boston stops Jokic. Like, who are they going to play? Robert Williams and Daniel Theis on Jokic? Jokic.
I mean, yeah, that's not bad.
It's not like
Theis is D'd up all year.
He's all right, but is he a much better defender than Montrezl Harrell?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Much better.
Much better. Yes. Oh, it's night and day. I think Trez is a negative net defender. I think Daniel
really?
Theis has done.
I've always viewed Trez as a positive net defender, yeah.
No. I think Trez was borderline unplayable at times. I think Daniel Theis has guarded every good center in the league this year.
All right. Well, I mean, I'll take your word on it. I will watch Daniel Theis a little
think,
closer.
I think it's a six or seven game series, though, with the Lakers and Denver, for real. Like, yeah. I'm coming around to six, I think, because I do think the Lakers are better than Denver. And I do think LeBron now realizes, like, yo, the path is open. Like,
oh, yeah.
The Lakers are the best team left. You're how old at this point? Again, I need to see LeBron decline and stop being good before I actually believe it. But LeBron knows. Like, he knows his history. He knows his NBA. And he knows that Father Time is eventually going to come here sooner than later. They are the best team left. The Lakers are the best team left in the NBA. I think he knows, obviously, what it would do for his legacy if you go out and get the fourth ring with the third franchise.
Yep.
You know, it's there. It's there for the taking. I don't think they're going to cakewalk this by any means because I think a lot of national people have undersold whoever comes out of the East. Like, I think whoever comes out of the East could very well mess around and win this thing, too.
Yeah, the narrative all year with the East was the top four teams were good.
Yeah.
Like and you thought the Bucks were going to be the big, or at least not you, the Royal
the Bucks
you
are
again.
Frauds.
Yeah, you think the Bucks are frauds. We've said that. And they looked like it so far, so I can't argue with you. But the narrative was those four teams and then the Bucks being the best team would be the only good and the rest of the East was trash. But you're right. Those four teams have been a little bit underrated. And looking at it from a Laker lens, because that's what I do, because I'm a Laker fan, I think the Heat might be the worst team left, but I think I'm most scared to play the Heat.
Exactly how I feel.
Yeah,
too.
I was about to ask, who do you think is the scariest team for the Lakers?
I mean, it's weird because it just Miami has Jimmy Butler. Like, at the end of the day, and Bam can defend AD.
That was the point that got me.
And so that's where I'm like, because at the end of the day,
you got Iguodala to guard LeBron, Iguodala, and Jay Crowder.
You
throw a little Jimmy on him.
Like, the Lakers, there's just something, because AD and LeBron are the best duo in the league. They fit super-duper well, and I'm never really going to pick against LeBron. But the Lakers supporting cast just doesn't scare me that much.
No,
at the end of the day, like,
our third best player is either Danny Green, Kyle Kuzma, or playoff Rondo.
Right. And so when Lakers have been winning consistently and have taken care of their business, so it's hard for me to pick against them. But I think the Lakers have been definitively better teams than Portland and Houston. So to that point, I actually am really curious to see how they do against Denver, who I think is by far the best team that will play these playoffs. If they struggle against Denver, I think you absolutely have to look at them to be vulnerable, not only to Denver, but to both of these Eastern teams as well. Like, I think the Lakers are the best, but I don't think they're the clear favorite the way we've seen a lot of times in the NBA in the past couple of seasons.
Yeah, I think I would definitely bet on the Lakers. I don't know what the odds look like right now, but I think the Lakers have the clearest path. And when I look at Denver, I think no one on their team is big enough and strong enough to stop LeBron. I don't think they have a big that can stay with AD. So our two best players don't match up really well against this team. And then you flip it and see how the Nuggets match up against the Lakers. And I say Jamal Murray. I don't think for the full game he will be guarded by LeBron, but LeBron in the fourth can take Jamal Murray. And plus Rondo, plus Danny Green, we have smaller guys who can guard Jamal Murray. And then same thing for Jokic. I don't know if AD plays on him the entire time, but he can probably be a net positive defensively, and so can JaVale, and so can Dwight Howard.
Yeah.
So I think,
well, that's the other change too, is it's just obviously, like with Houston, you have so much small ball, and now you've got, you know, quite literally the opposite type matchup. So that'll be interesting as well with the Lakers, see how they adjust.
For the Celtics Heat matchup, obviously they're going on right now. It's halftime of game two. Celtics up 60-47. I don't know what the game looks like, because I haven't been watching any of it. I'll have to rewatch it, or at least the highlights a little bit later. What do you think about that matchup? Obviously, Bam had that huge block at the end of game one. I think that and how this team has progressed throughout this playoffs has shown, in my opinion, I think they're probably the toughest, mentally tough, physically tough, toughest team in the playoffs overall.
Yeah, I think this series is always a coin flip to me. I've got Boston winning in seven. I just think Boston's wing matchups provide a little bit of a more difficulty for the Heat. I think we kind of saw it a little bit in game one. It feels like they ran out of gas down the stretch, especially in late game type situations. But they have a closer as well. I think Kemba Walker, you know, 5-point game aside, is a really, really good player in that situation. We've
Jason
seen
Tatum
him do this
might
how
be
many
developing
times.
Into that closer.
He
too.
Is. He looked like he was a little out of gas in the overtime game. I mean, they were giving it to him multiple times. He was getting those looks. I also think, again, Gordon Hayward is the wild card here. You get Gordon Hayward back into the lineup, I just think that changes how they can defend Miami so much better. But again, this is a coin flip type series. But neither of these teams beat it. Like, they both defend well. They both play within their roles. They both have their heart and soul guys. You know, there's just a lot to like about both of these teams.
Yeah, it's going to be, I think it's probably the most evenly matched up series. I think you mentioned how evenly matched up it was. Just to wrap up the pod, thanks for stopping in, by the way. He is Kevin Rafuse, host of the Driving This NBA podcast. You can get his podcast everywhere podcasts are available, and you can listen to him on Orlando's Evening News on WDBO 107.3 FM and 580 AM. He is the anchor of that show. To wrap it up, where are you predictions-wise on how this season ends? I think we've mentioned it a couple times, but let's get it on tape or on wax, I guess, if you want to go that way, and give me the final prediction here for this NBA season.
Oh, so I've got Boston in seven, and I've got Lakers in six, and then I have Lakers in six in the finals over Boston.
I think I'm with you on that. Lakers in six. I lean Boston in this series, but it really is a coin flip in the East. I want to say the Heat because I just like watching this Heat team play, mm-hmm. and I'm a huge Bam guy. You know how much I love Bam. Zach Lowe wrote an amazing piece on Bam Adebayo earlier in the season. I think it was pre-pandemic, and I fell in love with the guy.
He wrote another one on the Heat today and how they kind of did the rebuild so quickly within the last 2 years. Yeah. I mean, you look at it too, the Miami Heat were kind of in dead cap space hell as recently as 2 years ago. A lot of their contracts didn't age that well. But I mean, it's a couple of things. Miami is run extremely well organizationally. Mm-hmm. Miami also has the advantage of they're Miami. NBA guys love playing in Miami. Now, I don't think Jimmy, ironically, I think is the one guy who's probably not allured by Miami and really just goes there because he wants to win. And he loves Pat and he loves Spo and all those guys. But, you know, Miami is one of the few NBA places that will still have that location draw. Like, I don't think there's many anymore.
Yeah,
because
it's LA,
it's
Miami. I think Miami has one even more than LA now because of the no state tax.
Yeah, and the Lakers are still the Lakers, though. Yeah. Like, I think you underestimate. I mean, the Lakers did everything wrong in the past 3 years going into LeBron and still got LeBron and Anthony Davis. Like,
it was a clinic on
how not to manage a team.
Calabasas,
it still doesn't matter. Yeah, LeBron said he wants to come out in Hollywood, and then once he got Bron, it's everything is easy. Once you have a star, everything else becomes easier. I mean, we've seen Milwaukee, Oklahoma City, you know, none of these teams have won the title, unfortunately, recently, but you know, the reality is that you can win anywhere and you can be successful in today's NBA. I mean, since 2000, besides the Lakers, who's been the best overall franchise? San Antonio, most likely. San Antonio's not a note. I mean, it's one of the bigger cities in America. I think it's number seven. But it's not exactly like
seventh biggest city in America.
Yeah, surprisingly big in San Antonio.
Did not expect that.
Yeah. San Antonio's a great city. I went two years ago.
I just go on what Charles Barkley said.
What did he say?
Just the women aren't pretty there, essentially. I don't want to be dismissive.
Never mind. I don't want to get in trouble on this podcast, but I just thought it's always
what he says about San Antonio.
He must have been in the wrong spots then.
I mean, probably. I don't know. I've never been, so I can't tell you. My girlfriend did go to school in Dallas, so I know that's on the other side of the state, and Texas is huge, but
yeah, they're not close at all. not remotely.
But all right, Kev, thank you for stopping in. We'll talk to you next time.
Yes, sir.
Hey, this is Travis Dever, Kai's Real Estate, the Dever team, New Smyrna Beach. Your source for real estate and everything else, New Smyrna Beach. Proud sponsor of Knightline. Call me anytime at 386-690-1636. That's 386-690-1636. Let me show you my hometown, New Smyrna Beach, UCF's favorite beach. Go Knights and charge on. Hey, this is Travis Dever, Kai's Real Estate, the Dever team, New Smyrna Beach. Your source for real estate and everything else, New Smyrna Beach. Proud sponsor of Knightline. Call me anytime at 386-690-1636. That's 386-690-1636. Let me show you my hometown, New Smyrna Beach, UCF's favorite beach. Go Knights and charge on.
All right, going solo in the towards the end here, I guess. I actually haven't edited the podcast fully, so I don't know where this is going to go. I think I'm going to put this at the end. So I wanted to dive into NFL Week 1 and just give you some thoughts. I'll do some NFL picks here towards the end. I actually researched some of these, unlike last week, so you can have a little bit more confidence in these. And then I'm going to do something I think every week, that is the NFL MVP week-by-week rankings. I'll give you my top three players who I think is the NFL MVP up to that week. So I'll do that at some point there. So let's start off with just week one thoughts and give you guys a little story before I give you my thoughts on week one. So I missed pretty much the whole Sunday slate. If you're following me on Twitter and seeing what I was talking about, I could not get my Sunday ticket to work. So I was on hold for hours. And then I was on the phone for hours with DirecTV and AT&T and their support. I think at some point I might have talked to NFL Sunday Ticket people. I don't know. It was this whole thing. I was on hold and on the phone for hours. And you can check out my Twitter. I did a whole, not a whole thread about it, but just multiple tweets about how long I stayed on hold. Long story short, I still don't have DirecTV Sunday Ticket or NFL Sunday Ticket. And I don't know if I'm going to. So I missed a lot of the Sunday games. I watched the Monday night games, which were, you know, fine because they were on ESPN. And I could watch them, you know, because technology works most of the time. But not on Sunday Ticket, apparently. So that was a really frustrating process. And I DM'd and tweeted at DirecTV and AT&T help and nothing. So if you had trouble with it, you weren't the only one. I had a whole issue on Sunday. I wasn't able to watch any of the 1 o'clock slate or the I guess I watched some of the one o'clock slate, the stuff that was on regular cable, and then the 4:25 game with the Bucks and the Saints. I was able to watch that as well, but it wasn't fun, and I hate DirecTV right now. So until they allow me or figure out a way for me to get an NFL Sunday ticket, I will always hate DirecTV, because I need my football. Simple as that. I just need my football. So that was my first takeaway from week one. It sucked because I missed most of it. I was able to watch a bunch of highlights and catch up and listen to podcasts and whatnot to really understand what happened in week one. And I did get a lot of it through that, so I feel pretty comfortable talking about it. Not as prepared as I usually like to be, because I actually watched the games, a majority of them anyway. But I still was able to have some takeaways. So the first one was on the Thursday night game, which I was able to watch easily. No thanks to DirecTV and Sunday Ticket. I'm probably going to harp on NFL Sunday Ticket all podcasts. Well, not all podcasts, but during this football segment, because it really made me upset. But try to be a better person through it. Anyway, first takeaway from the Thursday night game, last Thursday, because I'm recording this on Thursday, not the Browns and Bucks from the opener. Texans and the Chiefs. Clyde Edwards-Helaire on the Chiefs is not fair. It really isn't. He is phenomenal, but that Chiefs offense with a running back like Clyde Edwards-Helaire isn't fair. It isn't fair. He's really good, and they're really good with him. I think when you're as good as the Chiefs are right now, you have to play with one hand tied behind your back. And I think that one hand is your running back needs to be either 40 or just like out of the league, You have to figure out a way to just have a bad running back that's like universally agreed upon as a bad running back. I don't know who that is. Maybe it's not going to be fair because I'm going to name some random guy. And the first one that came to mind was like Bilal Powell, which I think he's a fine running back and he's a pro, and he's a pro for a long time. But I don't think he's on a roster, and if he is, he's definitely not a starter. So, but a guy like Bilal Powell, no disrespect to Bilal Powell. He's a fine player, probably a good person too. I don't know. I don't know anything about him. All I do know is that he is not a starting running back. So that's the kind of guy I think the Chiefs have to play with at running back if they're just going to be this good. And Clyde Edwards-Helaire being the guy on the Chiefs is not fair. So that's my first takeaway from week one. Next takeaway is my views on the NFC North might just be my worst take that I will have all season anyway. I had, just to remind you guys, I had the Vikings making the Super Bowl, the Lions being good and finishing second in this division, the Packers regressing based on Aaron Rodgers not playing as well because of the whole kerfuffle with them drafting a quarterback in the first round in Jordan Love. So, and then I also said the Bears would suck, and they beat the Lions, who I said were good. The Packers demolished the Vikings. I know that score says it's like 43-34. It wasn't that close. It was not a nine-point game. It was a demolishing at the hands of Aaron Rodgers. And Aaron Rodgers alone, him throwing the football, not this Green Bay Packers, you know, pseudo 49ers offense. No. Aaron Rodgers threw the hell out of the ball and made me look stupid. And this Vikings defense, granted without the Nell Hunter, which I think was a big caveat in me picking the Vikings to be as good as they were. They do have Yannick Ngakoue, so they should be better. They were demolished by this Packers team, and it really, Aaron Rodgers' ability to throw the ball against these cornerbacks was a factor I did not think was going to play out to this large of a level. I did not think the Vikings' lack of cornerback experience or prestige or just ability was going to be this bad. I didn't think their corners were going to be this bad is what I'm trying to say. And Aaron Rodgers was just able to take advantage of it. The pass rush wasn't there to supplement these corners. And yeah, I might just be completely wrong on the NFC North. So take that as you will. Next up, let Russ cook. He's good at football. I mean, I knew this, but this whole offseason was this conversation around let Russ cook. Should the reins be let off Russell Wilson and you let him throw on first and second down and you let him take advantage of you know, his ability to throw the football really well instead of just pounding the rock like 30 times? And they kind of did that, and it worked. So I'm hesitant to say that this will be something that carries over throughout the season. No matter what happened, Pete Carroll is still the head coach of the Seattle Seahawks. So there's a good chance they will run the ball a ton for the rest of the season. I don't know if that's for sure going to happen, because week one was promising to watch. Watch, quote unquote, watch. That was one of the national games I got here, so I did get to watch more of that one versus the Falcons, obviously. And I just hope that Pete Carroll sees how good they played and continues to play that way. Obviously, they'll be a little bit more balanced. Pete Carroll did come out after the game and say, or I don't know if it was after the game or during the week, he did say that they need to run the ball more. So we'll see if that trickles down to Brian Schottenheimer and his play calling, and eventually to Russell Wilson on the field. But maybe Russell was just like, you know what, I'm just going to audible into passing plays every single time you pick a run play. So we'll find out. We'll find out if that continues. But it was promising and it was fun to watch. And Russell Wilson is an MVP candidate, and we'll talk about that when we get to my NFL week-by-week rankings, which is right now. Actually, I'm just looking at my rundown. It is next. like I mentioned earlier, this is the section where I'll tell you the NFL MVP rankings, as it's called, up till that week. So week one, we have 1 week of evidence who should be the MVP at this moment. And right now my top three goes like this. Number three, and this is probably my only one that's a little bit out of left field, and that's Clyde Edwards-Helaire. 138 yards rushing, three touchdowns on the ground. Statistically, he was the best running back in the NFL in week one. He had, I think, 5.5 yards rushing. I think he's phenomenal. And as of now, based on the evidence I saw with my eyes and the numbers that I've seen, Clyde Edwards-Helaire is number three on my NFL MVP week by week ranking. Number two, and this may surprise some of you because he's going to be talked about as the number one guy and get a lot more publicity than number one. Maybe a little bit more. Depends on what part of the country you are, I guess. And also, it goes back to my NFC North bias, so we'll talk about that a little bit. But number two, Russell Wilson. Obviously, let Russ cook. He had a hell of a game. 322 yards passing, four touchdowns. And they're 1-0, and they beat a pretty good Falcons team. Not pretty good. A mediocre Falcons team. Let's go with that. And then number one, and you may have guessed it by me mentioning the NFC North, Aaron Rodgers. 364 yards passing, four touchdowns. They beat a very good Minnesota Vikings team, a team that I think can be great. I even picked them to win the Super Bowl. To make it to the Super Bowl and lose to my Ravens. Just reminding you that I did pick the Ravens to win it, so they looked really good. So Aaron Rodgers, right now, first on my NFL MVP up to this date ranking. And to finish off the NFL solo segment, I'm going here, and I guess the podcast depends on. I guess I have to wrap up the podcast with this segment. So to finish up the podcast, I'm going to give you my NFL picks against the spread for week two. So the first one that popped out to me, is the Cowboys -4 at home versus the Falcons. I have no confidence in Atlanta's defense. Their offense looked good, but they were forced to throw the ball a ton against the Seahawks when they just went up a bunch. So that's a product of Matt Ryan just chucking it down the field. I just don't trust them to be able to stop this Cowboys offense or really just stop them, their ability to maintain possession by running the ball. Or just the D-line is probably the thing that got me the most. I don't think the Atlanta defensive line will be able to cause any discomfort for Dallas. So that's my first take. I like Grady Jarrett. I do, and obviously they paid Dante Fowler, but I just doesn't do it for me. Didn't do it for me against the Seahawks. So we're going to go with the Cowboys at home -4. Next up, let's go with the Vikings. Yes, the Vikings. +3 at the Colts. This one's as simple as I picked the Vikings to win the Super Bowl, right? I can understand that the Packers were better than I thought, and they were a 13-3 team last season, and they came out and they just whooped the Minnesota Vikings. I can understand that because the Packers at least have some pedigree. I don't think the Colts are good. I think they're average, maybe average at best. I don't want to go that far because I don't want to upset Chris Crawford, my good friend. So let's go with they were just average. I think the Vikings should be able to go in to Indianapolis, Lucas Oil Stadium, and run the football effectively. I really do. I think Dalvin Cook might be the key in this game for the Vikings. And I don't think Phillip Rivers showed us much in week one. I said he could end up being good, and I feel like I was wrong. I already feel wrong. I don't feel as wrong about that as I do about the NFC North as a whole, but I don't feel good about it either. So let's go with the Vikings +3, a 3-point dog. Are they +3? They're +3? Did I read that right? So they're 3-point underdogs. So they could lose this game. Wow, I really don't know how to bet. You guys should really not listen to my betting takes. Let me just make sure here. I'm pulling up the line right now. +3. Look at that. That means they're underdogs. I get it. They're going to Indianapolis, but they don't even have to win this game. I think they will. I think they'll win it outright. Let's go with the Vikings there. Vikings plus +3. Feeling even better about it now that I read that correctly. Next up, this one is not a great one. This one is a stretch. And it's probably my spicier take here. But the Patriots, plus +3.5 at Seattle. I don't know if they win this game, but I think they'll be able to control the ball. We saw what they're going to do. They're going to go Tim Tebow, you know, Bronco, sort of a lot of designed runs for Cam Newton. And I think, I don't know if this is accurate, but I think I heard this was the most rush attempts he's ever had in his career, or at least close to the most rush attempts he had in his career, in his first game as a Patriot, which is just, it just screams Bill Belichick. Bill Belichick's going to use you and what you're great at. And Cam Newton's one of the best running quarterbacks of all time. And before Lamar Jackson, you can almost argue that he is the greatest running quarterback of all time. But that's a different conversation. I haven't really done enough research to make that argument. But I do know that Cam can help this team score some points and maintain possession of the football. I think defensively, you'll see a lot better matchup for the Seahawks than the Falcons brought to Seattle. Or at least I forgot where that game was. Regardless, the Falcons defense is not the Patriots defense. I think we all are on the same page about that. So let's just assume the Patriots are going to play defense in the way that we think they will. And I think that the hook really gave it to me, because I think it might be a field goal game. I'm going to go with the Patriots here, plus +3.5 at Seattle. It's a terrible take. It's a terrible take. I trust Bill Belichick a lot. I have some trepidation in thinking that Russ will cook once again. We'll find out on Sunday. I think this game's on Sunday. We'll find out on Sunday. So those are my picks. Cowboys minus -4, Vikings plus +3, Pats plus +3.5. I guess I'll keep up with these and let you know how I've done. I forgot who I picked last week. So sorry about that. I think I picked the Rams against the Cowboys. I'm pretty sure about that one. And I'm pretty sure I was right about that one. So let's just pretend like I'm 1-0. So 1-0 for the year. Let's see if I can make it 4-0 with these three. At least 3-1. Let's stay above 500, or at least just stay at 500 probably. But those are my picks, and that's it for the NFL segment. I guess we'll call this the weekly NFL roundup. I don't know if I'll do this every week, but I did it this week. So there you go.
Spice up your company with homemade marketing services from Tasty Gravy Creative. Tasty Gravy serves up the menu of budget-friendly marketing, graphic design, and public relations services customized to your specific goals. Co-owned by a UCF graduate, Tasty Gravy can help refresh your brand, strengthen your online presence, or reinforce your company's message. Contact Tasty Gravy for help with your website, social media, marketing, advertising materials, and more. Visit tastygravy.com.
Hey Jeep Wrangler owners, have you ever sat in your office at work and watched the rain just pour into your Jeep because the weatherman said that there was a zero chance of rain? Or you put your doors back on because there was a 100% chance and then not a drop of rain fell? Well, there's a company out there that can help take the worry away and give you the peace of mind to be without your doors. The company's called Life Without Doors. They make waterproof rain curtains and dash covers for Wranglers. Life Without Doors is there to help make the decision to leave the doors at home an easy one. Find out more at lifewithoutdoors.com.
Yeah, guys, thanks for sticking through. An hour long today, something like that, an hour five, I don't know. I don't keep track of these things, but this is podcast number 29 of the Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast with me, your host, Sam Albuquerque. Please rate, review, and subscribe to the show. 5 stars are always appreciated. I didn't mention this is exclusively on the Knightline Sports Network on Apple. You can get us on our own separate feed On Spotify and Stitcher, it's just Take a Left at Albuquerque. Make sure you pick the updated one because there should be two. We're going to delete the old one eventually. We just want to make sure everyone migrates over before we do that. So we'll be back next week on Friday, I think. I did start graduate school, as I mentioned earlier in the podcast, so my schedule may change a little bit. But for now, we're going to stick till Fridays and see where it goes. Please follow me on Twitter at Sam B. Albuquerque, and go ahead and send us an email if you want to get in touch with the show at sam.b.albuquerque@gmail.com. Albuquerque, spelled like the city in New Mexico. We'll see you guys next week. Peace!